Thanks for the opportunity to talk to all of you here on the LCN conference. So I will try to describe the technology journey we have in front of us. From today's sort of where we are at today with the introduction of 5G, and then towards how we are seeing the evolution the next 10 years towards our 6G vision. Carl will help me with switching slides here and show the videos, etc. So let's hope that we have the technology with us. So please, next slide. So in order to try to understand where we're going, we need to spend a little bit of time where we are today. So we are there at the dotted line there, 8 billion 5G, or 8 billion subscribers, basically, of mobile broadband that continue to increase up to 9 billion. And you can clearly see how the 5G system will start to be introduced, and it will sort of gradually then be replacing, or it's like the 4G subscribers will also have 5G subscriptions, right? So the orange means that you have 5G subscription and all the other relevant subscriptions. So looking at the end of this time period in 2025, you can see that we are almost like estimating 200 million 5G subscribers. So it really expands quickly now. And there is a total of more than 75 sort of operator service provider that have switched on 5G now. So it goes quickly, and it's a little bit like for every presentation that for every generation that you're now having, the introduction of the new technology goes a little bit faster. And going from 4G to 5G is also made more flexible for operators, since you can reuse the same spectrum at the same time. So you can even sort of mix a 5G subscriber and a 4G subscriber onto the same spectrum band. And in that way, it's much more easier for an operator to migrate from 4G to 5G without having to turn off sort of 4G in order to release spectrum for 5G. So this is an important feature that will also make it go faster. So looking a little bit on the next slide, here we have a little bit sort of similar, but it's a little bit Ericsson on the top there. So there is a lot of commercial networks now and contracts that we are signing up all the time, and we are part of sort of 65 live networks today. So the technology is picking up quickly, really. And then what is making this possible? Going back to the spectrum, you can see there the example in pink there, the T-Mobile, and they are launching now. So they are launching something on low frequency band on 6700 megahertz. And then the mid band is the sort of key band for really promoting high capacity to a broad, wide area users. And then on top of that, this possibility to have extremely high capacity on the millimeter wave frequencies. So there is a combination of spectrum band that is then suitable for different deployments and different use cases. Korea, South Korea is really first out here when it comes to really shifting the traffic from 4G to 5G. And there is a lot of different devices available now on the market. And you can also see now how the new 5G users are using much, much more data. It's a little bit hard to imagine, but it's close now to 30 gigabyte per month. So that is 1 gigabyte per day. So users are really having it on all the time, and they are consuming, of course, downlink, social media services, Netflix, etc. But they're also recording a lot of their lives and upstreaming that, etc. So there's a super strong momentum behind sort of the usage of 5G when it comes to South Korea. And of course, they are very sort of early adopters. But this is now spreading, of course, and we see a strong introduction of 5G also in China and in the US. So it's really happening. So going to the next slide. I've talked now about the mobile broadband subscriptions, but on top of that, of course, we have the IoT connection. And also here we see a strong development, and even stronger actually. So this is what's happening now, a little bit before we have the 5G. So 5G will be sort of on top of this. So looking at the left there, you can see that the cellular IoT, sort of IoT connection provided by cellular systems. Then we have a legacy there on 2G, 3G. It's a lot of things connected to GSM today that will continue to be connected. Then on top of that, we have the massive IoT, which is sort of the new energy efficient, very sort of long battery lifetime, extremely good coverage versions of the LTE system. And on top of that, we have a little bit normal LTE connections, but used very much into IoT. You can think about surveillance cameras and things that generate quite significant number data rates. And then, so you see how this increases now. So we expect that we will go up to 5 billion here quickly on these systems. And then you can ask yourself, the IoT is of course larger than that. And then I think we are dividing the IoT now a little bit in the wide area IoT, where you can see then that the cellular IoT out of the wide area IoT is dominating. So out of the expected 5.5 billion users, 5.2 would then be on cellular IoT. But then we will also have, of course, the short range IoT, where we have the things connected over Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, etc. On top of that, and that's an even larger amount of connections. So you can see how this is really the foundation, I think, for the importance of 5G when it comes to sort of the new use cases. This is starting up now on the cellular IoT side. So going to the next. So the 5G, the new thing with 5G is that it's really opening up a set of new use cases. And this will be industries, enterprises connecting both their manufacturing and increasing efficiency in that part of the business, but also then, of course, connecting all the different products. So this will lead to a strong digitalization of the offerings from the company. So instead of having just rubber and steel, they will have sort of still that needed rubber and steel, of course, but a lot of the additional value will be then delivered through a software service on top of that. So a lot of the growth that we see in front of us will be in this virtual digital domain. And the 5G will then be sort of the base for that. So it will offer then the higher security, the flexibility, the performance, the predictive performance and everything. And on top of that, you will do all of these remote controls or real-time controls or automation and whatever you would like to do. And this is, of course, still in the beginning. And I think we are now seeing how the digitalization of society is accelerating, right? And this is the perfect platform in order to make that possible. So if you want to look a little bit deeper into what is actually this platform, so let's switch to the next. So we see really that this is sort of an innovation platform for the next decade. And this is a complicated slide, so let me walk you through it. First, it's important to understand the distribution here. So we have the devices to the left, where we have the phones, the cars, the factories, the drones, or I mean, the sensors, everything that you would like to connect. Then you have the access sites where we have the base stations. And then there are different sort of concentration points a little bit higher up this distributed site. And then operators have their national sites. And then it sort of gradually then connects to the global sites and to the cloud providers. So this is really, of course, the sort of distribution of this setting. Then the system platform then is built from bottom up here. So we have a transport layer, sort of connecting everything over high performance, flexible, programmable, typically fiber connections. Then on top of that, we have an execution environment for all different network functions. And this is then now gradually turning into a cloud infrastructure where we are using sort of the cloud technologies in order to have virtualized network function on top of that. Then we have the access, the mobility, and the network applications. On top of that, we have the management, orchestration, monetization things for the operators, and then we connected all different applications here. And here we will see how the transport is getting sort of programmable, resilient. We will see how the cloud infrastructure and the connectivity merge into a compute network compute fabric, offering this unified execution environment for these applications. We will see how the access, mobility, the network applications will have increasing performance now when 5G is being built out, and what we then see on top of that in the limitless connectivity. The applications that we see in front of us are, this is the Internet of Sense, I will talk about that. We see how the intelligent machines will be connected on top of this platform, etc. And we also see how this will be a key contributor in different sustainability aspects as well. So it's an enormously powerful machinery here. And it will get even more important when we connect the connectivity and the compute, and when we can have a network slice that could offer, for example, a high reliability, low latency, sort of both network and compute resources. So this is really the platform we are now building, and that we will have the coming 10 years. So going to the next. Just an example here, what's happening now. For example, the Industry 4.0, which is very much sort of initiated and driven out of German industry, but this is of course now all over. But we see collaborations where we are part between big industry manufacturing, so sort of Daimler Benz together with Telefonica, one of the also present in Germany operators. We have BMW with Deutsche Telekom, we have Audi doing things. And then we have, of course, the big Swedish companies that we are working a little bit closer with, Atlas Copco doing something with Orange. We have the ABB doing something with Telia, etc. And this is really all now trying to experiment and start to connect piece by piece in the manufacturing process. I think it very much starts with connecting these unmanned vehicle robots running around in the factory. You are connecting the materials. Later on, you will connect the robots. And in the end, you will have an extremely flexible setup where a lot of the activities in the factory are fully automated. And then you will gradually then go to full automation of your manufacturing. So this is one very strong use case for 5G. And there is quite a lot of an important market as well, right? Because there is a lot of manufacturing going on. And these are sort of high value use cases, definitely. So looking a little bit into that, just as an illustration here on this future. So next. So here we will show a short video. Hope it works now. It's something that we have recorded together with ABB. And it shows a little bit how you can, as an operator, will interact with one of these robots, how you can reconfigure it, and how these future factory settings might be perceived by the operator or the ones that are sort of owning the factory, trying to use the factory. So please, play the video. Yes, it's really sort of trying to give a little bit of a glimpse of a future control room and how you are working with this in sort of a VR, AR type of fashion. So go to next. And next, here we are, yes. So our vision is really then to empower this intelligent, sustainable, and connected world. And I think you see examples of this through all the different segments here. So for example, there is a lot of actions on the ports, so sustainable ports of the future, where we are providing connectivity for this logistics in ports, where it's automated and loading, offloading, transporting things within the port. This is a good use case because it's within the controlled area, so you can do a little bit more than you can do outside on public roads and cities, etc. So this is really a place where we are learning a lot on how to automate processes like that. It's important, of course, from a sustainability point of view when it comes to inclusion, etc., that the internet, these capabilities now are provided really, really worldwide and a deep coverage out also in very rural areas. And here, of course, there are many alternatives, and we are then providing possibilities to have special sites on high locations, high masts, high output power, using the latest sort of antenna technologies now being provided in 5G, etc. This will give extremely good coverage. Then, of course, we have over the seas, etc. We will have satellites. You can think of emergency situation where you can have drones or unmanned sort of high altitude platforms, etc. So there are a lot of opportunities that will complement the sort of terrestrial deployment as we have, but that we see them today. And if you really have the full coverage of all roads, etc., then there's a huge possibilities to reduce then the transport emissions. And this is a collaboration we do with Einride here. And taking away the driver out of this equation, it's of course possible to also go with electrification in an easier way, because then you can build these trucks a little bit smaller. They can run, and then they can stop, recharge, run, stop, recharge, etc. And you take away the sort of the cost for the diesel and the cost for the driver. The optimization and how that ecosystem will work will be very different. So it's really showing how these technologies will transform different industries and businesses. So this is where we are now, or where we are going the coming years based on current technology or technology being rolled out. So let's now spend time here on understanding where we're going after this. So next. So what will then happen now in the coming 10 years here? And next. But when we are trying to understand this and sketch a little bit what could be possible and what could be expected, I think you can identify a lot of technology forces that we do see, and these are sort of exponential in nature, all of them. So there is a huge development in all of these in a separate fashion. But I think our key point here is really how you can see now how all of these are connecting and reinforcing each other. So starting up in the left upper corner there, ubiquitous connectivity, that's of course something where we are driving and providing new technology, etc. And we have the 5G being rolled out, and we will see how the 6G now comes later on. So there is a strong development of the build-out of this infrastructure. Then there's a lot of things connected, IoT, where we also see then an extremely strong development and how that is increasing exponentially. And here, this will of course be a lot of sensors connected that will bring in a lot of data. And then, of course, with all of that data, we will apply AI to that data, and there will be a lot of new insights and optimizations and possibilities to create completely new offerings, right? But in order to do that, you would need a compute, so you need a cloud. And in order to make it real time and also not shuffling around all the data all over, you will need to move the computer a little bit closer to the different applications and where the data are generated and stored. Given that, of course, we would like to do a lot of mission critical things. So the trustworthiness of these technologies will be key. And this is broader than just the security of the connections. This is really need to be an end-to-end ecosystem effort here with all the different players involved in all the different use cases in order to have an end-to-end trustworthiness. Of course, it wouldn't be fun if we don't have anything connect, and the robotification and the development on that side gives, of course, a lot of promising when you see that development. And you will really see how the robots are sort of developing, being more and more capable and more intelligent. And by being connected, they will be even more sort of strong and be able to really build sort of systems of systems this way. Then we also see sort of the new ways of interaction. So we see the glasses coming. We have VR today, which is getting better and better. We will see, we will come now more interesting form factors when it comes to different AR glasses, etc. So here's a lot of development. And here we have the all of the Internet of Senses that we will come back to. It will take a lot of compute, obviously. I think we then, of course, see all the hardware accelerators that will be key for us, but also the possibilities of new compute paradigms. And there are sort of this memory close computing, it's the neuromorphic compute, and it's the quantum compute on the horizon that will offer sort of different capabilities, different characteristics, but all in all, we will have much, much more computing available. Then, in order to be green here, we of course need to use green energy, and in order to do that, we need sort of battery technologies. We need to connect the distributed generation of energy from solar and wind to this distributed infrastructure as well. So that will be a key thing. And then also there are a lot of basic research going on here. We have smart materials, etc., that could be used in different ways in order to have much more sort of dense compute. You will need to handle heat dissipation, which there are promises. There are, of course, needs to be in the antennas in order to tune antennas, etc. This possibility to have these 3D materials printed that can also then be changed after they are produced, etc. So there's a lot of things going on here. And I think you see how all of this connects. And it's really the combination of all of this that will make the big change here. So next. So what now? I will try to give you a little bit of a glimpse of this this future, and we will have time to go a little bit deeper in some of these. So if we start on the bottom there, you really need to see how the connectivity evolves. And I think being in that business, I think we have a clear view on how we will gradually make it more sort of suitable to meet the demands here we have in front of us. Then the trustworthiness, I think we have sort of built in security from the start when it comes to protecting the data in transmission, right? But we need to build in also how we protect data at storage and at compute. So there's a lot of technologies there. But it's also about the availability, the resilience against different attacks or it could be other circumstances, earthquakes, etc., that power cuts, etc., that we need to be able to handle, right? The complexity of this machinery will increase, so it has to be data driven, and we need to have the cognitive aspects being built from the pretty nitty details in the air interface up to the how you configure the compute and how you provide slices then to different industries. Everything has to be sort of fully automated. And then perhaps something that you are thinking about here as well, how will be the network and the compute? How will we merge these two infrastructures being built out now? How do you connect an edge compute capability that being offered by Amazon or Microsoft or Google to all the different operators that would like to provide that compute to the different consumers that in turn would like to have the flexibility to use the right sort of cloud providers for the applications that they would like to use and develop, etc. So it's a very advanced platform that we see there that needs to be done. But when that in place, and this will of course gradually be in place during these 10 years, it's not like that with nothing, and then suddenly it will be in place 2030. This will of course be developed over time. And then we will have these new use cases being. So we have the Internet of Sense, which is the full immersive experience on audio, vision, but also on taste and smell and haptics, and the touch, and everything around. The connected intelligent machine being more and more capable, building smarter and smarter systems, being more and more autonomous, and being able to interact between different systems and systems of systems, setups. Then the digitalized and programmable physical world is a sort of an infrastructure needed for the first two there, because in order to be able to move around, in order to be able to have your virtual objects placed in the real world, etc., you need sort of a fully digital representation of your surroundings. And you need to update that with all the moving objects in real time. And everything would then be sort of in a digital shape, digital version of the physical world, where you have all the objects represented by their digital twins in this world, and how the digital twins then are able to interact and talk to each other. So, and given this, we will have a lot of a positive effect on the connected, sustainable world, where we will use both the efficiencies around this, but of course also the capabilities to serve society in a much more inclusive way. So this is sort of the scenarios. And then next. So the 6G then platform, we released a white paper on this the other week, and we will have a link to that one in the end. We see then how the 6G is being built up of the trustworthiness, the network compute, the cognitive. And then we have all of these a little bit more detailed. Adaptability in order to be flexible in the deployments, the enhanced end-to-end connectivity. We will, of course, have extreme performance. Everything is sort of time 10s or time 100 when you go from 5G to 6G. There will be a lot of smaller devices that will be on a scale that we haven't seen. So they will be embedded in everything with sort of zero cost, zero energy type of setup. And then on top of that, we will see a lot of new applications that we sort of can't even imagine today. So this is a little bit how we are building up the foundation for this 6G future that we see. So going a little bit more into the details now. So I think I talked about this basically. So go to next. So we are now having to sketch this. So let me just have this one just to introduce the concept a little bit. We are talking about technology journeys. So we are out today where we just have 5G to be introduced, and then towards 2030 where we will be in the 6G world. And then there is of course a lot of things that needs to happen in order to be able to go from today to 2030 and all of these capabilities that we see in front of us. And then we have tried to sketch here what are sort of the technology steps, the stepping stones that we need to research on now in order to make all of this possible. So next. So let's start with the Internet of Sense and click once more. So this is a busy slide, but if you were to imagine, what would it take to offer a full Internet of Sense experience? Then obviously looking at the first row there, there is a lot of things needed when it comes to the devices and the sensing and actuation. So we have these smartphone tethered XR viewers today, a bit bulky, right? But they are getting better. then we will need to have sensors and actuators in order to have the possibility to feel and detect touch and motion. We have the body suits and you have the gloves and all of that, right? Then the XR glasses will be a much more attractive form factor, and you will have something very much similar to normal glasses as of today, connected to the network. You will add taste and smell. This is already sort of tried, right? And then you can evenly think about brain-computer interfaces. And this looks very, very much like science fiction, right? But there's already today trials and different ways to control. I think there are some drone competition where you actually then control the drone with the brain-computer interface, etc. So being research, it's still far out, but we see that in this journey. And when you have that and everything here in different, little bit different versions, you will have this full sense mobile internet. So then a little bit quicker than, in order to do this, then you have sort of the multi-sensory communication. You need to be transferring a lot of these things, right? So you need sort of these audiovisual digital objects. You need to have these shared objects. There's a lot of haptic capabilities that you need to support. You need to have all of these digital objects being transferred. And if you can do this, you can even have sort of shared biological experiences. What could that be? I mean, it could be a doctor feeling the pain of a patient, for example. Would that be possible, really, if you connect the patient's brain then? Could you actually do that or not? So there's a lot of these things that are totally out of today's imagination that are sort of going to be possible with all of these technologies. And in the end, I mean, the virtual and the real world will be mixed here in a way that it will be difficult to separate. Then, in order to get the performance and able to do this in cost-efficient way, etc., there's a lot of algorithms and interesting technology that needs to be developed. So we will need to have network-aware rendering. It will be difficult to have the GPU processors out in the glasses. We will have much of the compute on the network side, and then we will sort of transfer that in an efficient way then in order to be able to have an attractive form factor and battery lifetime, etc., of the devices. I think one of the key things here is the spatial mapping. You really need to be able to understand the surroundings, exactly how the surrounding looks. You need to localize the user in order to be able to put the different objects and interact with different objects in a good way. It will be enormous data sets here, so more of a machine learning based compression of holograms, etc., would be needed. I think the full body tracking, the body has a lot of degrees of freedom, and that is also something that needs to be done. And then, of course, in order to get a good experience, we know how important it is to get sync of everything. And this, of course, going into this immersive world, the sync would be even more important in order to get the right experience. You will also then, if you want to use the brain-computer interfaces, I guess you need to be able to transfer the brain waves into models and the digital signals, right? So, and the opposite as well. So you need sort of to learn what the brain waves means and can store that in a model in order to understand it, etc. So of course this is a completely new field as well that needs to be researched. Then a little bit, if you do connect all of this, you do feel that the trustworthiness will be key, right, if you do this. So you need a lot of resilience and privacy, etc., in these things. And then in order to do this, you will need the network platform. And here we have a lot of different things that are needed and that could be supported. Obviously, you need really to support the spatial mapping. Obviously, you need to have this ultra reliable low latency communication, which is really reliable. And for example, you need the brain type communication type of thing to transfer this brain information through the network. And this will develop then into this full sense mapping platform. So now we have a short video again on illustrating how the Internet of Senses could be experienced in a few years out. So let's play the video.
Okay, let's see. A dinner party.
Food selector.
An Arabian Nights.
Playing music. Main course suggestion.
Looking good.
Personal table setting. Changing tiles to theme.
This is better.
Changing personal table setting. Checking calendar. Sending invite. Victor accepting invite. Emily accepting invite. Thomas accepting invite. Composing message. Surprise Anna at the party. Ingredients from digital store. Tasting mode.
Nice.
Emily and Victor are vegans.
Okay, maybe a plant-based stew?
Alternative main course. Vegan stew. Ordering vegan stew. Your friends are here.
Come on, you guys.
Perfect dinner location selected.
Yeah, thanks a lot for this illustration here from our friends of the future. This is, of course, an extremely, it could be a lot of fun. And you also realize that these technologies needs to be used in a good way. And there is a lot of excitement, of course, for a future like this, but there's also a lot of concerns around security, etc. So I really hope that this inspires you to think about how this future could look like. So next.
Okay, let's see.
Next.
Sorry, there was a glitch on my side here.
Yeah, no problem.
I will quickly browse to the right slide. See where we are, Magnus. Is it here?
No. I don't see the slide yet. I don't know.
No, yeah. Let me see here. It should be on the right slide. I need to do resharing. Because after the video, things got a bit messed up. Can you see the video now or the slides?
Yes. And now let's go walk a little bit faster through the last three things here. So we have a little bit of time for questions as well. So the connected intelligent machines is sort of the next area that we see in front of us. So next. Yes, thanks. So here, there is a similar thing, right? So the intelligent machines as such will evolve. They will be much more capable and they will be able to do more and more intelligent reasoning and learning on their own, so to say. Then to really make this powerful, we really need the data formats, the support of this communicating machines, which are different from communicating humans, obviously. So there is a need for a different type of interoperability. Then introducing the machines, there will always be this human-machine coexistence. So in the beginning, humans will assist. Then there will be a human-machine collaboration type of thing. And in the end, I think it will be the machines that sense and predict our actions and informing us about their intents. in order to really make this fully possible, there is a lot of systems of systems type of things here going on. So in the beginning, perhaps you orchestrate everything. Then it will be more dynamic, it will be self-organizing, and then it will be fully autonomous systems of systems. Again, the trustworthiness will be key here when it comes to be able to introduce this. And when connecting a lot of machines, there will be a lot of safety questions as well, putting a completely new set of requirements onto the end-to-end systems here. And again, the platform will then support these things with services for these machines in order for them to be able to communicate. And there will be intelligent AI capabilities in the machines that need to be able to, so one AI need to collaborate with another AI, and that needs to be supported then from a communication point of view. So it is really then the network as an enabler for this cognitive system. So looking at the next, this digitized and programmable physical world, which is a little bit of then, as I said, an infrastructure for the previous two. So next. So here there will be a lot of devices, sensors, actuators being connected. So we will go from the wearables, and then it will get more and more body sensing and all the way to smart dust. A lot of things being connected by. Then, of course, again, there is a digital representation of this. We are sort of supporting the creation of these digital twins of all objects and places, and sort of the sensor fusion around this. And then taking care of this digital representation in the form of digital twins. And you can even think about digital twin mobility, how the digital representations are moving the digital twins in order to keep real-time properties in the physical representation of this. Then this will of course help that you can be fully programmable, so you can do sort of simulations and you can sort of explore sort of what will happen in this digital version, and then you can change that, and then you can transfer that to the automated world. Here we have a lot of identity management of these twins. Again, in order to do all of these things on top, there will be a lot of trustworthy and privacy questions that needs to be solved and addressed here. A lot of extra, I think the positioning, the timing, all these kind of localization type of support will be key. And here you can even think about using the radio system as a sort of a radar, which can then make a 3D model of the physical world updated in real time by us using the radio infrastructure, then going up higher in frequency and then have sort of a radar image of the surroundings. And all of this needs then to be supported by the network platform here as well. So next. And then the connectivity thing here. I think I said most of this, but let's bring it up again. So next. I think when we think about this, the sustainability and together with this connected sustainable world, I think we of course need to make sure that our industry is sustainable, the sustainable ICT in a way, right? So of course we need to be resource efficient. We need to use energy, lean system, green energy, etc., and have recycling of everything that we are sort of providing. Then of course there is a lot of responsibility sustainable questions here, and that's around everything around the human rights, the privacy, the liability, children online protection, the transparency, traceability, all of that is really not fully in place today, and that really need to be strengthened in order to really have this ICT connectivity then supporting these things. Then these things will be an enabler for a broader view. So from an inclusion point of view, of course, it's important that we are able to provide equal digital opportunities. We are able to sort of create future jobs and being able to handle the fact that jobs will disappear, being automated and creating other kinds of jobs. we need to have the digital, the education, the healthcare, and also make sort of this, all of this data and privacy aspects a little bit more in the center of the discussion. Then that would be, that would be used then for a lot of functions in society. And of course, we would like then to provide this connectivity for all and really have sort of the systems being the foundation in order to offer all of these services that expected in this future society. And then last but not least, we already now have identified in this exponential climate action report how ICT infrastructure can really contribute now significantly to the 2030 target. So by using the ICT fully, we are really making a contribution to this exponential climate action by having this dematerialization. That is, you provide a lot of value in the digital domain, you can have a growth in the economy without sort of using more material. And the material you use, by being it connected, it can be more circular. So all in all, I think the contributions from this infrastructure would be significant. So we all need to work in order to make that happen. So that was the last thing, I think. So if you go to next here, this is the final slide. What I talked about now is very much covered in this white paper that we released last week or the week before that. Ever-present intelligent communication, a research outlook towards 60. And you have the link there where it can be downloaded from our page if you want to read more. So by that, I'm happy to shift over here to a little bit of discussion and questions, please.
Thanks a million, Magnus, for this very future-oriented keynote. So I'll open up for questions either in the chat, or we are a little bit more than 40 people. I think people can also speak orally directly. So please go ahead, ask your questions for Magnus. People are a bit shy. You don't need to be shy.
Yeah. Are there something in the chat there?
Let me see. I will open it here. People had some connectivity problems in the beginning, but that was solved.
Okay, it's more like this.
Yes. So let me ask a little bit what we are doing with you, Magnus, from Ericsson Research side in terms of innovative applications. I'm talking about the test bed we have together with you and different sites and different application areas. Maybe you can comment a little bit of what we are doing in terms of trying not only 5G, but what could be done the coming years in terms of innovative application developments and so on. You have some people in Luleå working together with us with remote cars. We have video surveillance and so on. Perhaps we can share a little bit of what we are doing together, Magnus.
Yeah, I think we are creating a little bit of this innovation platform, right? So we have 5G coverage now in the campus, outdoor and indoor. And we also have the activities by RISE and the data center and the edge data centers being discussed, which we also now are doing a pilot on, right? So we will have both the localized compute and the connectivity. And then there is a lot of industries, of course, in the region that is interesting to try out different things, how to make their operations more efficient and trying to understand how this platform can be used going forward. So that's sort of my view of the situation. And of course, it might be so that there are some detailed projects going on, which I haven't really been fully informed about.
A lot of small things and bigger things. Yeah. We have the mine not too far away from here in Skellefteå with Boliden. I saw a new contract with Telia and Ericsson Hardware where the full automated mine is the future vision, not too far away actually, with 5G indoor connectivity deep down in the mines. So that's fascinating to see those things seem to come true quite soon. So,
yeah, exactly. I think mines are a little bit similar to ports, right? Mm. It is sort of a confined area.
Mm.
And there is a lot of gain to automate that. And of course, in the mine, there is of course a lot of hassle to have personnel deep down in the mine. And if you can avoid that, you can increase your efficiency a lot,
mm.
obviously.
I would like to ask a question, if it's possible.
Go ahead, Nils.
Okay, yeah, thanks for the great talk. I'm wondering a bit, so if we currently see that 5G is deployed, right? And my impression is that we at the moment not really using the whole data rate and the whole services, this low latency and so on that 5G is offering us. And you now presented us a whole lot of use cases that look not that different from the 5G use cases. So my question is, what are the killer apps you really see, killer applications, killer scenarios that you really can't, that really will, where's the need for 6G compared to the use cases we were already envisioning with 5G?
Yeah, that's a good question. And the truth, I guess, is that what we describe here are use cases that we believe will be sort of developed on top of the 5G evolution over the next 10 years. Then in the end of this period, I think we will see then a little bit more of these futuristic use cases. And then given what is then being the, then we will figure out sort of what the gap is, what could be covered by a 5G evolution, where do we need a new technology, and then we will have sort of 6G developed in order to be able to scale these use cases broadly, right? And then we will have the 6G platform deployed, and then we will start to speculate again on new use cases, etc. So it's extremely difficult to see the use cases that will sort of really be used on 6G. I think we are seeing the use cases that we believe that will be developed now over 5G. And then would 5G be the final generation? I think with what we see now with the development on the Internet of Senses, the communication of the holograms, etc., and this fully synchronized immersive experience, I think we are seeing data rates and requirements, which is extreme. Most likely we will need to optimize for that. Then of course, on the machines, we just introduce it. This is the first sort of generation of connecting all of these things, automated, making this the network of connected machines. Again, believing that we have figured this out perfectly in the first try would be naive, I think. So it will be, I think we will, it could be so that these communicating machines, they are actually being the majority of the usage of the networks in the future. So having these distributed AIs being solving different things, communicating, learning, and collaborating, that will give rise to demands which is not fully understood today, and by that perhaps not fully possible to support with a 5G evolution. But then exactly what 6G would be then, that depends on how this gap is getting clearer and clearer in the coming years. What can we not solve? Sort of? Where are the needs that is not yet possible? And that's of course a guess and speculation. Now we figure this out. But I think we have a lot of interesting research to do in order to take us forward on this journey, because we will not figure it out unless we are deploying all of these things, trying, see where the borders are. Thank you. Thank you for that question. I think it's sort of a key to understand the story here.
There's a more detailed question about data rates and latencies in 6G, Magnus, in the chat. I don't know if you can see the chat.
No, otherwise, I can read it. I'm sort of looking at your slide page here. Right?
So yeah, it's Ryan Ullislam from LTU asking, in 6G, it will be higher data rates and lower latencies than 5G. Can you comment about that? You said something about 10x and 100x I don't think the specifications are there yet, but maybe you can comment a little bit.
No, it's not. I think for this immersive feeling to have, to feel that you are fully synchronized from a human point of view, you are sort of in this below 10 milliseconds. I think musicians talk about 7 milliseconds or something. So there is a need then for a person to feel fully, that experience are fully synchronized. And perhaps we can address most of that. If you were to think about the network compute fabric, where you have compute capability, storage, where you have data sort of distributed and compute distributed, and you would like to view that as one operating system, I guess even lower delays would be a lot of value if you want to have compute happening both in the device and on the network side in some sort of distributed manner. Then the machines, here we don't really know, but there we don't have any of these human restrictions, right? So a machine can of course can generate infinite amount of data, it can consume infinite amount of data, and it can take advantage of even lower delays in order to optimize further. So how much of the market could be supported with 1 millisecond, and what will be needs fractions of milliseconds? An open question, but I have the feeling that if that's provided, people will innovate on top of that and use that in a very, very good way. So that has how it has always been. And I guess that's a little bit of view that we have when providing this infrastructure, that we're trying to make it possible, providing it, and then there will be a lot of innovation on top of that. I mean, how could I imagine everything that happened on top of 4G when we talked about 4G, right? And so on. It's really taking us by surprise for every generation, and the power of this innovation is enormous.
Right. I posted a link to the white paper that you published last week, Magnus, in the chat so everybody can read it. Perfect. So that's good. I think we have room. Next session starts in 15 minutes, so we have room for one or two more questions if anyone is eager to ask questions to Magnus.
There might maybe one question from my side, going into a similar direction as Niels has asked. So I see that we have an increasing gap between the standardization and the implementation and adaption of this 4G, 5G, maybe then 6G. So I see already that now we're basically implementing 5G, but still, for example, a lot of M2M communications is still running on the good old GSM, and still there's no real complete adaption of, for example, 4G narrowband IoT or some things like that. And I assume that there is this increasing gap, or maybe it isn't. Maybe you have a different perspective on that. So it would be interesting to hear your comment on that gap between adaption and standardization.
I think you could. I can agree that this is something that is always a challenge between sort of inventing new things and talking about this, what could be done in 5-10 years, compared to sort of building the market and getting the adoption of the technology that we have today. And it's a lot of different things that needs to be in place all the way from the device towards that the networks are there and the applications are there, etc., in order to make it happen. But on the narrowband IoT and the wide area IoT in general, I think we are seeing this exponential growth now. It's clearly sort of moving, and it's not yet sort of hundreds of billions of connections. But if we continue to grow in this way, we will be there, right? It will, over these 10 years, it will be an enormous amount of connected devices. So it is happening. So in I would, of course, wish that it happened faster, of course, etc. But I think it is happening. Yeah, and it's always difficult with these exponential things, right? You always underestimate them, overestimating them in the beginning, and then you underestimate them a little bit further out. So I think a lot of these things will kick in, and so we will see these things. It's just a question of a few years, I think. So I'm not so concerned by that. But still, of course, I'm sort of research, looking at the future and etc. If you are more on the business side, obviously there is a lot of limitations and challenges that you see that you currently need to address. So it's a little bit of a research perspective I have.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Very good. If someone has one more question, we could take that. The chat seems to be in good shape. Nothing coming there. So by that, I want to thank Magnus a lot for joining us and giving his insights on what we can look into the future. So I'll give the hands, the claps for Magnus. and we stay in touch, Magnus, and we will see when we get to meet again. I'd stay in contact with your people in Luleå also, of course. So thanks a lot. Next session starts in roughly 12 minutes. I will hand over to Lias as the account manager. So see you
thank
soon.
Thank you a lot. Thanks for,
thanks a lot,
listening.
Magnus.
Thanks for the conversation.
Perfect. We stay in touch. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.